So hello everyone, welcome to our event. My name is Vivian Cao. I'm a third year medical student at Torocom in Harlem, and I'm a member of the New York Society of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation.
And I'm Lisa D'Souza. I'm a fourth year medical student at St. George's University and a member of Representation Rehab on the Mentorship Committee. And we are going to be your co-hosts for the night.
I want to thank everyone for making it out tonight, and a special thanks to all of our panelists for volunteering their time and their knowledge with us on the process of making a rank list and matching into our dream residency program.
I just want to make a note that we are going to be recording the attending portion of tonight's event and then uploading it to YouTube. And tonight's event is brought to you by a special collaboration between the NYS PM&R and Representation and Rehab.
So just a little bit about who like the New York Society of PM&R is. We're a New York-based organization that represents and spreads the ideals of physiatry for attending physiatrists, residents, and medical students. You don't need to be in New York to take advantage of our benefits that we offer as a society. And if you're interested in joining us as we continue to host events such as online journal clubs and in-person workshops, we'll put a link in the group below in the chat, and you can sign up for a membership with a discount code that we have for you tonight.
And then Representation in Rehab is an organization run by trainees for trainees. We are aiming to help underrepresented in medicine explore physiatry and create opportunities for medical students to get involved within the field. We have many resources available through Representation Rehab, including a mentorship program, away rotation application guides. And if you're interested in joining our community, we have put our website as well in the chat, and you can find us on social media as well.
I'm going to just briefly introduce all the panelists that we have here tonight. So to begin, we have Dr. Chowdhury, who's the program director at Burke Rehab. He's also the former APD at Downstate and the program director of NYS PMR. We also have Dr. Stephanie Rand, the program director at Montefiore, and Dr. Ruth Alejandro, the pediatric rehab medicine attending at Blythedale Children's Hospital. And she's also the assistant dean at the New York Medical College and the executive board member at NYS PMR as well.
We have three more. So we have Dr. Stern. She is the chair of the Arthur S. Abrahamson Department of Physical Medicine Rehabilitation at NYC Health and Hospitals in Jacoby. We have Dr. Lopez, who is at NYU, and he is the APD at NYU, and Dr. Cesar Constante, who is at SUNY Upstate, and he's a clinical instructor and attending physician at SUNY Upstate. We are going to try to limit answers for each question to around 5 minutes so we can get through as many questions as possible. But we're going to start off with our first question just because we're limited on time. We're going to jump right into things. So the first question is, what are some important things to consider when making a rank list? And what are some tips on how to decide how to rank one program over another?
I'll jump in. I think it's, I tell, you know, most of the applicants when we interview them that at the point where you're getting to the interview, you've done the hard work. Now it's a matter of figuring out what's the best fit for you in terms of the program. And you want to look for somewhere that you're going to be happy, you're going to be content with what you're doing, and the type of program adapts to what your goals once you graduate are going to be. And I think geographical location also plays a big role, especially if you have family nearby. So I think that's a very broad answer, but just to get started there.
For me, it's prioritizing training. You have 3 years to gain all the skills you can to move on to the next steps. So being a bit flexible in other things, but you know, if you need support, if you need to be in a certain location to excel at your training, that's a part about, but you really want to go to the place that's going to make you the best physician, not necessarily the easiest residency, but one that forces you to work, to get skills, to become a better physician. That's my opinion.
I think the other thing to also remember is, you know, to think about your profile and, you know, in terms of ranking, if you want to rank to like Ivy League programs and you're a mediocre student, you have to sort of really weigh your risks. And so, but if you're AOA junior or AOA, you know, you can definitely reach and go other places. But definitely, you know, aside from that, I agree with Dr. Chowdhury and Dr. Palasante. Definitely pick places where you're going to have good training, you know, more, you know, good rotations. You know, like NYP has tons of rotations, different hospitals that they work at, and some really good interventional teaching. So it definitely depends on what you want to go into.
So just to add to what everyone else has been saying, I know all of you have heard this before, but you know, you have to rank in your true order of preference. What does that really mean? It means that you would rather go unmatched than go to that program. That's the question you have to ask yourself. Would I rather go unmatched than go to this other program? Because you do not want to be in a program that is malignant, that you know that you're not going to be happy with. You're just going to be miserable. So you have to ask yourself that particular question. Will I be happy being unmatched than going to X program? The other thing to consider, and this is probably less of a factor, but you know, if you look at way into the future, does that program that you are ranking have a fellowship that you might want to go into? Do they have a pediatric rehab, you know, fellowship? You know, there's a good chance that you would match at that program for a fellowship. I know that's way in advance, but, you know, nowadays, this is what residents are thinking. And lastly, the piece of advice that I like to give is go with your gut. What feels good? I mean, not too many people talk about that, but what feels good to you? Just go with your gut. But keep in mind what everyone else has said.
I think Dr. Lopez had a really good point about when to leave a program off, right? So, you know, you want to maximize your potential for ranking, but you do have to know when a fit isn't right for you. And in this new-ish interview space where you have the ability to interview at programs virtually that you may not have flown to were it an in-person system, you have to decide whether or not you're going to include every program that you interviewed at on your rank list. So that's a really good point for the bottom of your list. For the top of your list, make it be where you want to train. You know, you've heard this already, but it's true, right? The match is in the applicant's favor. You lose nothing by putting your first choice first, because if your first choice doesn't rank you at all, the list goes to your second choice. This is the way the algorithm works. We call it a match, but it's not a match in the sense of a New York City public school match where both people have to choose to rank each other number one. If you rank Montefiore number one and I rank you number 10, but I don't get numbers 1 through 9, I get you. So it doesn't really matter where a program sees you on their list. It matters where you see them on theirs. The other thing to consider for a lot of you is the balance between categorical programs, advanced programs, and non-PM&R programs, right? So if you are applying to different programs, which the AAMC data says you are, and in the current PM&R state, you'd be foolish not to apply to both to advanced and categorical programs, because we're pretty split in that system. You have to be careful as to when you make your rank list, whether you're putting intern years above categorical programs and vice versa. And because whichever one you match, whichever one goes first will automatically knock out the other programs that don't then meld with your match. So if you say, I'd love to do this internal medicine year, but only if I match at that PM&R year, you have to be careful as to where you put them in your list. So just watch that as you're making your list. There's no right answer, categorical, advanced, anesthesia, FP, PM&R. It's what you want to be, as Dr. Lopez says, where your heart wants you to be. But you just have to watch that as you make your list, because whichever one comes first will kick you out of the running for other programs below that if you can't do one and not do the other.
Great. Thank you for everyone's responses so far. Our next question is, when should a letter of interest and or thank you letter be sent?
I don't think there's a right answer. This is a tough one. You know, a lot, every program director is going to be different about how they review this. I wouldn't send it too late. You know, once we start to approach this time of year, programs are starting to plan their rank list meetings. So after we interview everybody, and this is pretty standard across the country, I'm sure not everybody does it this way, but it's a pretty standard way of working. We interview everybody, and then all the interviewers schedule a meeting, and we meet and we talk about where they fell, where the interviewees fell on a rank list. And we decide from there, do we want to move people up, down? Do we like it the way it stands? You know, there is a reality to having multiple interviewers and maybe not always having the exact same interviewers every time, that you know that there may be some variability from week to week. So you want to talk about people, you know, you bring up everybody's pictures and their applications and you rethink the list, you know, interview list is a great starting point, but you keep going. So you don't want to send any emails after the rank list meeting, right? Once the rank list meeting is done, most program directors are done. I think it'll be great if the AAMC goes in and says, which they're talking about doing, but it won't be for this year, that, you know, programs have to submit their rank list before applicants, because that would give that freedom. I'd love to see that happen. You know, for Monty, we're having our rank list meeting next week. So any emails that come in after Wednesday, that was very lovely of you, but it's really, we're not re-meeting, you know? And it varies program by program. Do you have to send a thank you? No. Do some programs sit there and tally whether you thank you or not? Yeah, probably. Do all of them? Absolutely not. It varies. And then you have to realize, if you're sending a letter, you have the freedom as an applicant to do that. As a program, our responses are very limited. We could be withdrawn from the match for giving you an idea of where we want to rank you. You're allowed to say, I'm ranking you high, I'm ranking you one, I'm ranking you whatever. I am not. So we have to be really clear in our responses to be safe in that way. So I think thank yous are great. You know, personally, I kind of miss the handwritten thank you days, because, you know, program directors didn't have to respond to them. You got a thank you, you moved on. Now it's like, thank you, no thank you, no thank you. And how long can we go on for that? But just, if you choose to send them, fine, good. Earlier is probably better than later, so that they're read, and don't read too much into the response to your thank you.
I agree with Dr. Rand. That's great, good advice. I usually say, you know, send a thank you like a week or two after. I always say, take notes with who you interviewed, have their name. And if you connected, and let's say you discussed, let's say you want to go into brain injury or PED rehab, and you met with someone and discuss a specific topic or research or something that you've done at a, you know, PEDS, you know, conference or some kind of workshop with kids in New York City, you know, and if you connected, write that down so that you can have that in your email. And that's an emotional reminder, right? our memory remembers the emotional stuff. And so if you can reconnect with that person in the email and say, thank you, I was so happy that, you know, you did a brain injury, you know, discussion or talk or presentation with Dr. Flannery or Dr. Sifu. And, you know, I really want to go into brain injury. You know, those are the things that you should mention and say that you were impacted and it was great to like meet that person and that you want to go to that program. I think it's a good thing to have those reminders, get the spelling right, how you connected, and then just send them out as soon as possible. If you do something new, if you had a publication that came out or you got an award as the best resident or you became chief resident, well, actually, yeah, because it comes out in April. It depends on some programs. They come out in March. You can send them an email and say, hey, I just became chief or I just published this. It's okay to send a second email. If they tell you not to email, I would respect it.
I think well, one quick thing. I know we have to move on to the next question. One thing I noticed some students do in their thank you or letters of intent that's very helpful. They put their name. They also put their ERAS ID, and they usually put their same photo that they had with ERAS. That's pretty helpful for jogging the memories. Like Dean is here in the chat. His Zoom picture is the same as his ERAS picture. So if he were to email me and use that same photo at the end with his signature, it'd be pretty helpful. I guess we could go, Dr. Lopez, if you want to say something, then we could go on to the next question.
Yeah, I just want to say something really quickly. So the love letters that we receive, if you're going to write a love letter to a program and you're going to give them a letter of intent, just give the one program that you're going to rank number one. Don't try to avoid sending that you're going to be my number one choice to like all of your entire rank list. The reason why is because once every 2 or 3 years, I have read a letter that says, I intend to rank Mount Sinai number one, but I'm from NYU. So I've gotten that once, we get it once every 2 or 3 years. It's the wrong program director, it's the wrong program. So really, 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 really proofread your love letters and make sure they're accurate, make sure that's the program that you really are gonna rank number one truthfully. And if you do more than one, really, really proofread that, please.
Your next question goes along similar to that. So it's a great segue into that. The next question is, when should a letter of intent be sent? And what are your opinions on ranking highly emails to your second and third choices?
I'm going to just answer really quickly, just along the lines of what I said. If you say that you're going to rank us highly, you're probably not going to rank us number one. You know, if you're going to say number one, say number one. If you say you're going to rank us highly, we're not your top choice. And that's our feeling at our program specifically.
Personally, I don't use them. I don't put them into our algorithm. I agree with Dr. Lopez. When I get the I'm going to rank you highly email, I kind of say, that's nice. You know, I might rank you highly too, but that doesn't mean, you know, define highly, you know? So it may be more meaningful for fellowships that have a smaller applicant pool. I don't know. I've certainly sent the email as a program director to fellowships for my residents on behalf of them, saying my resident intends to rank you number one and I really, really, really hope you'll consider them. I don't know, they kind of seem to work coming from a program director, but that could just be because my residents were wonderful and you know, deserved it regardless of the email. I can't swear either way. I don't have actual data on that. I'm not sure they're necessary. I think that at this point in the process, you've done the interviews, they've met you, they have, you know, people already made opinions. I'm not sure that it sways much. I've not really ever heard from a program director colleague that, oh man, and then I got that letter of intent and I moved them up from number 10 to number one. Like, I'm not sure that that's a thing.
Okay, great. Thank you. The next question we have is, how do you rank applicants when you have both categorical and advanced positions available?
I'm feeling chatty, but I do have both advanced and categorical positions available, and I'm not sure that my colleagues do. We keep almost the exact same list. There are some variabilities that we will see. I will move applicants down my categorical list if they've already completed an internship, and that's a benefit to my institution at a financial level. You only get funding at the CMS level for 4 years of PM&R. And if you've already done an internship, you know, the institution cannot bill CMS for your PGY 4 year if it's actually your PGY 5 year. So if you've already done an intern year, I will move you down my categorical list. I have rarely moved people up my categorical list if I have a deep conviction in their ability to be a physiatrist and a question about their ability to match into a internship, and I really want to secure that for them. But for the most part, the lists otherwise are exactly equal.
Dr. Rand might be the only one with a program like that, so I'm not sure the rest of us have a lot to add.
Okay, we can move on to the next question then. This is a question for, when looking at brand new programs, what are things that you would be concerned about, and how can residency at a new program affect your chances at matching for fellowships, especially if their programs lack some exposure to subspecialties?
I would say, like, a big thing is, you know, a lot of things are promised early on, but it takes a while for things to get set up. So having a real idea of what is the timetable, how far along in the process. You know, at a new program, if they're telling you we're going to have pediatric rehab in a year, but the paperwork hasn't even been filed yet, it's unlikely. You know, there are advantages to being at a new program. There's not a lot of barriers or fences. If you're very driven, you can build things and work towards things without a lot of people telling you no or telling you that's not how it's done here. Along with, you kind of get to lay the groundwork and probably have a quick pathway into being and attending there also when you graduate. We haven't heard from Dr. Colasante. Anything you got there to add?
With regards to a new program, I think it's a double-edged sword. Like you said, if you're very driven, you can kind of somewhat make it your own and take a lot of advantage and opportunities. But there's also, in established programs, there's going to be set pathways and set connections that may be useful. So, for example, in our program, we have connections with Syracuse University for those that want to do research with mechanical and aerospace engineering department. We have, you know, multi-million dollar grants running in different programs. So I think it just makes it a lot easier in that sense to get plugged in. But there's pros and cons to each one.
Okay, great, thank you. The next question we have is, what advice do you have for students who don't successfully match and how to approach soaping?
So I think last year, was there only one spot for the soap in PM&R for the whole country?
Yes. Yeah,
so I don't know if that's a very useful question to discuss, but yeah, I don't know. I think there was only one spot.
There was one spot. It was in Rochester. But right. Of course, if you don't match entirely, you still need to secure that internship. That's extremely important. You know, if you don't match, and I sincerely hope that this applies to none of you on the call, but if you don't, be prepared to move quickly. That's probably the best reality. It'll be a quick process. It is a kind of multi-rematch cycle now. It's a little different than the older cycle where you just cold called people. But if you're concerned that that may be you, I would make sure that whatever rotation you're on at that time, you're able to take a couple of days so that you can really devote yourself to reapplying and being available for rapid conversations and programs are going to move quickly. If this is the case, you're going to want to be available for calls. Hopefully it's nobody's issue. I'm sure that your schools would be willing to work with you for the time off. No school wants a student to go unmatched at the end of SOAP period, for sure. But it just be prepared to move fast.
And segueing with that, I don't have any data on this, but if, let's say in this case, Rochester had an open position and there is a medical student that graduated doesn't have a position, I would think that maybe they would encourage for that person to apply for that position. But I don't have any data on that, just as an example.
I'll add a bit about kind of the intern year. Like if you're soaping for both, you know, it's tough for the PM&R part, but one thing to think about, like if you're soaping into an intern year, is how does that location help you build up your PM&R reapplication? So we had one student, she matched to a community hospital out in Long Island, relatively easy intern year. She's going to reapply, but she really didn't have much connection there with any PM&R department. You know, she did a PM&R elective with a private practice paying guy that doesn't, you know, getting a letter from him didn't change her application any, versus maybe you do a tougher one at, let's just say like Bellevue Hospital in New York, you'd be attached to NYU and you might get more chances to cross over with faculty, do an elective with them. So thinking about that, if you have to soap into a intern or surgery or something like that.
And I'll add, you know, it's important to lean on your deans. You know, they, as Dr. Ann said, they definitely don't want to have residents, you know, med students who don't match for residency. So they are prepared to meet, and then they go to their career specialty advisors, PM&R, anesthesia, neurology, whatever, you know, specialty they didn't match into, and they call their advisors, and then they start calling all the program directors and they start making phone calls. So definitely lean on your Office of Student Affairs.
Thank you, everyone. The next question is, do applicants need to take both Comlex and STEP? And then what role does their score play into ranking for applicants?
I actually once asked this question on our program director listserv because I, a couple of years ago, was asked by TuroCom in Harlem to give a speech about, you know, how to get into PM&R. And this was one of the questions that was asked of me. And as a DO, my first opinion was, no, you absolutely don't need to take both. But I was like, you know what, let's not just go with my opinion. So I put it out on our listserv through the AAP. We have a listserv of just program directors. As scary as that may sound to you, yes, we do talk behind your backs. But not about you. It's really not scary at all. And I asked, and I said, does anybody require USMLE or is Comlex accepted? Every single response was Comlex was accepted. You do not have to take USMLE. Some program directors may feel more comfortable analyzing it, but in the reality, when speaking to PM&R program directors, they get it. They understand how to correlate Comlex scores and USMLE scores. So you don't have to worry about taking both.
In terms of weighting the steps, you all already know that step one is already blinded. It's already passed, no pass, I should say. I, at my program this year, made a huge change to the disappointment of many people reviewing applications. I blinded step two scores. As long as you passed, you're in our applicant pool. We did not eliminate anybody unless they had a failing grade. And so I'm moving forward, and this is just specific to my program, but I know other programs are trying to do something similar, where they're trying to level the playing field in terms of board scores. So at NYU, we blind the scores to the application, the reviewers. So if you pass, you've got a chance at our program. I can't speak for everyone else though.
Great, thank you. The next question is PM&R research or PM&R specific research weighed the same as other fields of research? And do you have any recommendations on how to get more involved in research?
I always try to have, you always want to try to find PM&R specialty advisors. So, where I'm at New York Medical College, I'm a career specialty advisor for PM&R. And so I meet them. If they know early on that they want to go into PM&R, I can sort of take them under the wings the younger they are. If they learn about PM&R later on in third or fourth year, then that's when I start to give them advice. I help their development in terms of get some research done, make sure you have some leadership skills, join the New York Society PM&R, try to shadow, try to do different type of workshops to, show your dedication. But if, let's say, at the last minute, they realize and they found PM&R, I think if you have research already done, and you explain how you learned about PM&R and you're showing interest that's new and that you're starting to develop that relationship with PM&R and you apply, I think it's acceptable. But it definitely looks better if you show early interest and you're dedicated and show, just like when you apply to med school, right? They look at academic metrics. They look at your, personal statement. They look at your, letters of recommendation, but they're also looking at your experience. And part of that experience is not just, did you do shadowing and clinical rotation? But, if you have some research, it's going to be helpful. If you pivoted and learned about PM&R and then switched, that's okay. But you got to start showing some of everything else that will help buttress your application.
If we can move on to the next question. What can a student do to have a successful audition rotation? And what is the best time to rotate at a program that you're really interested in?
Yeah, I think as far as like program you're really interested in, it's going to depend a bit doing some of your research as to like getting one-on-one time with the right people there. So like, if you want to rotate with the program director, if the program director is only on service this 2 weeks or something like that, or let's say they run the SCI service, but your elective is on the TBI service, it might not quite work out for you. So doing a little bit of research there. So whether that's in July or September, I think it's better that you spend the face time with the people you need to. On my end, I think it's good to get the most impression, I guess, would be right around the time of interviews. And, knowledge is a spectrum. Some people are ahead, some people are behind. But as long as you do the stuff that's free, reliability, punctuality, accountability, those are things that really shine through on my end. But I don't know if the rest of you guys have anything to add.
I think it's a really good question because it's are you trying to get the letter of recommendation or are you just trying to secure face time, right? So really, you want to make sure that you get your PM&R rotations in by early September so that you can get those letters in for ERAS opening, right? When it comes to just trying to secure interview spots, that's a really tough call. Certainly rotating once all interviews have been given, I wouldn't really expect that to change your chances of getting an interview. The way that the AAP is pushing and the way that the AAMC is pushing signals over interviews, interviewing at a place alone is not meant to guarantee you an interview. And this has to do with equity for students, right? Different medical schools allow a different amount of away rotations, and different students have different means for for flying and for getting housing and for taking away rotations. So the idea of signals over way rotations is meant to be equitable for students. So while it's a great idea to get FaceTime, I also always tell my students, you have to know who you are as a person. If that's your only goal, first of all, you got to send the signal anyway. But second of all, you got to realize whether you're a person that's really bright and shiny from day one, or do you take time to warm up at a location? Because if you're a warm up kind of person, you may not want to go everywhere. You may want to let your application speak for you, and then you can turn on your bright and shininess as best as you can for interview day. Whereas if you can make a really great first impression, okay, fine, go everywhere. You'll probably make a better impression with the residents than you will the program directors. The program directors will be looking for people who can write a good note. You know, not just stay, right? We all know how to stay later on an away rotation, but we want to look for the subtle things that show competence, and that can be hard to do in a 1 month period. So you got to really weigh why you're going. If you're going for a letter, you got to go for a letter, right? We all know we got to get a certain number of PM&R letters in that application. But if you're just going for FaceTime, I don't know. I would try to conceive of other ways of getting your name on the list.
I agree. I think I just finished a dean's meeting at New York Medical College, and we were reviewing some of the residency applications overall for all specialties. And the stats are actually showing that when medical students signal, which didn't exist when I applied, there was no signaling or anything like that. This is new, you know? So, but the stats now show that if the medical student signals the programs they really want to go to, plus puts in their geographic preference in addition, because that's something else you have to add on, your ability to get accepted to the programs you want to go up. Now, this is removing like what their profile looks like, what their grades are. Just those two things are really important. Sometimes for the geographic preference, they have urban, urban, suburban, suburban, rural, rural, you know, and then no preference. Like, so if you're in the Northeast, you're going to want to indicate that. If you are open to like traveling anywhere, you can put no preference. And that's also a safe thing to add. But still statistically, if you want to stay in the Northeast, put that you want to stay in the Northeast. Or if you want to sort of be in the rural area, because maybe you're, you know, from Montana, or you want to be in the rural or suburb area, put it down. But statistically, it helps if you signal where you want to be. Find out if your program, if you have a safety, you know, you want to stay, let's say, at New York Medical College and Westchester Medical Center is where you want to be. We tell our students, don't even signal us. We want you to save it for other programs. We will always like take you in, except, you know, sort of interview you. We will rank you high so that they can save their signals for other programs. So lean towards your specialty advisors at your dean's school. Talk to them about these percentages. And then I think just so that you know, those stats are there. Signal and put your preference geographically. And you have to consider, like, do you have a partner? Is your wife applying to family medicine somewhere else? You know, is there a reason why you need to stay, or you can travel anywhere? It's important to discuss those issues ahead of time.
In addition to what Dr. Alejandro and Dr. Rand said, I just want to speak to the question about how to present yourself in a rotation. I'll make it really short. I just don't want that resident who's going to be overzealous. You could work hard, but don't be the overzealous medical student on the floors, because believe it or not, our residents, our faculty, they're all evaluating you on the floors when you are at your rotation, your audition rotations. Don't be that overzealous medical student.
It's a 360 evaluation. You know, so, you know, when we meet at Cornell for NYP and we have a selection resident meeting and we do, I mean, you know, ranking list, you know, we get input from all the residents, from some of the therapists, from some of the nurses, even the a secretary or administrative assistant that, you know, puts the food out at time to eat and, you know, you're all gathering socially. They'll keep an eye on like, who's the person not talking and kind of like not really communicating and looking nervous and who's like really social. All of that is taken into consideration. So I always tell everyone, be very social, you know, just, you know, be yourself and talk to everyone. But again, of course, don't be too extreme in either way. And, you know, bottom line, you know, if you have a passion for PM&R, it'll be reflected in your profile, you know, and if you follow everything you need in terms of looking at your whole profile, you know, you work hard at getting the best grades you can, you get your, you know, your rotations and your sites that you want to visit with specific programs, you get your letters, you know, you get your experiences, you start putting in that you were on the Medical Student Council for the New York Society, that you were part of AAP for Medical Student Outreach. Like, you know, what did you do? That's the important part. And then I know at NYMC, we have mock interviews. So as a career advisor for PM&R, I take in all the med students that want to go into PM&R and I'm increasing those numbers, which is great. And I say to them, okay, let me look at your entire profile. Send me your MISPE, which is like how you did on every rotation. You know, what are your quality letters from each rotation? And I will look at your profile like someone who is interviewing you ahead of time. And I'll ask you questions like, why did you want to go into PM&R? What's the best clinical experience you had on a rotation? Let's talk about that. What was a, you know, a rotation that you had or a clinical case that you had that was really difficult? So we'll practice those questions so that, you know, you can prepare. Because you want to, you know, you want to be able to present your best foot forward. You know, you want to be as positive as you can be, smile as often as you can, even Zoom things like, how's the lighting? What do you have in the background? You know, take away the Marvel comics. Yeah, I know you love all this stuff. Just keep it neutral in the back, a little planned, you know, things like that. Lean towards, you know, doing meetings as much as possible with someone who will help you along. And there's career advisors in medical schools. If anyone needs to email me or wants help in that sense, I can help out as well.
Thank you. Our next question sort of builds off our last one. So besides getting an audition rotation, what are some ways that IMG students can stand out and connect with programs?
Yeah, I think for at least me, like I do a lot of volunteering with sports, like adaptive sports or races, things like that. Volunteering, you know, is free. You could end up at the same place as the program you're interested in. For example, the New York Marathon, when I was at Downstate, we would always try to get towards the end and there'd be people from other residencies that were interested in our sports fellowship that would volunteer at our tent with us. And that's an opportunity. You're not able to rotate at the hospital, it's another way to get.
Okay, if no one else has anything to add to that one, besides showing an interest in the field and understanding what physiatrists do, what are some ways applicants can stand out?
It's so hard. You guys are really applying at a difficult time when there are so many applicants and it's virtual and it's a little bit hard to answer because we don't know where applications will go. And I know that's stressful for you guys because the, you know, ERAS, AAMC are changing things and they've combined with Thalamus and other specialties are looking at additional application systems. So we don't even know where the world is going right now. And this is really looking at this past application system more than we can even say for next year. Signals were a big deal. We know that the data, as Dr. Alejandro said, is clear. Signals matter. They help you to get seen. It looks like people who signaled a program had like a 1 in 3 chance of getting interviewed and people who didn't had a 1 in 10 chance. And that's real numbers, right? what you can do often depends on which program you're applying to. You know, Montefiore is a service-based hospital, a service-based system. We're looking for community service, sense of devotion to that. Mount Sinai is a research institution. They're looking for research, for a sense of devotion to that. You know, you're not going to play the game and be perfect for everybody. So I think realizing who you are and which programs align with your goals is the best thing you're going to do as far as setting yourself up for success in applying and interviewing and matching.
Dr. Rand, this is a tough question also, but I like to answer it this way. In your application, you should document things with meaningful purpose. And what I mean by that, as an example, if you've done research, say it's cancer research, and then you've done a master's in something related to cancer, and then you've volunteered at, you know, PM&R cancer fellowships or something meaningful. It has to be consistent to stick out instead of a hodgepodge of things. I know this is a general answer, but we are looking for something that's very, 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 very consistent and meaningful that will stick out on its own. And I hope that helps. Just having a hodgepodge of things looks nice sometimes on paper, but when you really, really look down granular, it looks so disconnected. There has to be a connection to everything that you've done. You need to tell us a story, and it has to make sense to us. I hope that helps. I really hope that helps. But that's what I've instructed all of our, you know, reviewers to look for. Just look for something that's consistent with meaning.
Totally agree with that. That's so spot on to show you have a story. My story, I was 16, hit by a car, polytrauma, survived coma, broken leg, broken, you know, pelvis. And you know what? I met the physiatrist who changed my life. You know, I was impressed with ortho, but didn't like the OR, you know, like, so when I was in med school, I was open to learning about different specialties, but I always went back to the PM&R doc who changed my life. And so that was my story, you know? So I think if someone has a story, not that you have to have like a dramatic story like that, but I think if you show consistency in wanting to be a part of humanistic medicine, you know, I always describe PM&R as the jewel of medicine. And when I have a med student who, as an M1, meets with me and says, hey, I want to be a part of the, you know, the PM&R interest group. And I'm like, an M1, yay. You know, I'm like, Matthew is president and you connect with Matthew. I want you to meet Dr. Stern. I want you to rotate with blah, blah, blah. So like, I start preparing them. And I get them to be part of a New York Society PM&R, because here also with this society that's so important and has been longstanding in New York State and impressive nationally, you know, you get to network and you get to learn about different programs and you get to learn where you fit in. And then you get to learn about yourself. So I think it's great, because I think here you can really get a lot of support, but definitely agree 100%. Try to have a story. And I think most PM&R candidates do have that story. And I think that's why, as I mentioned, this field is the best field. And this is why our numbers are going up. More cream of the crop medical students are applying. And not that you have to be one, but you know, you just have to really be focused on patient care.
Great, thank you so much. The next question we have is, how would you recommend finding mentors and letter writers for students that do not have a PM&R department at their home institution?
Start by asking your medical school, hey, who do you have? If you don't have anyone on campus, do you have anyone that you connect with distant in the community, you know, because we want to start pushing as medical students for PM&R presentation. So go to your dean, go to your the Office of Student Affairs and say, hey, I want to go into PM&R. Where is this person? Where is your advisor? Most schools now have advisors, but definitely lean on advisors, get to, you know, join societies, get to meet other people. And then you get that mentorship. Then you start getting to learn more about others who can then support you and help you when you apply.
I want to take a sec to highlight representation and rehab. Maybe Lisa, Dorothy could say more, but for mentorship, they really started a really good program. You guys want to talk about it a bit?
Lisa, you want to go ahead?
Sure. So we started a program where it's mentorship families, where we try to connect either residents or attendings to a couple of different med students that are all in different aspects of their medical school journey, whether it's an M1 or an M4. And then that way, like, everyone can kind of mentor each other. The attendings and residents can mentor, the attending can mentor the resident, but the resident can also mentor the med students, and M4s can mentor in that as well. It's a really great way to find a sense of community. I know it was something I felt when I was in PM&R, to find a way to break into that community. And that's really what we're trying to get, is that you have a sense of community within this field. It's a great field, and it's a great way to have that community.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of good societies out there aside from, you know, Representation Rehab. New York Society does a lot. Those of you that are DOs, the AOC, PM&R is pretty good to get involved with as well. And most community PM&R docs are very approachable, very happy to help people learn about the field. There's not a lot of us who are constantly trying to grow it. So just reaching out to someone locally, it might be a good starting point, and they could help connect you or open a door to somewhere else.
Absolutely. And we'll make sure to put our Gmail over into chat too. Our mentorship program is kind of towards its tail end, but I'm pretty sure we can still add on a couple of mentees to our mentorship families.
Vivian and Lisa, are we one more question, or is it time to wrap up the attending portion?
We can squeeze in one more. What are the best ways to use a gap year when applying to PM&R?
Keep it consistent with your story, as Dr. Lopez and Dr. Alejandro talked about. You know, certainly staying in PM&R in some way would be ideal. This is, I guess there's two different gap years that we could be talking about right now, right? The I didn't match at all into an internship gap year, or the I've matched into an internship and I'm not yet into PM&R. And those are two really different scenarios, right? Is it the gap year where you already know you're going to go, and then what am I going to do for a year? Research is a great way, getting involved in your institution. Like, if you've already matched into a PGY2 program, but you have a gap year after your PGY1, talk to your 2B program director and figure out, you know, ways to start to get involved and hit the ground running. If you've graduated medical school and you have nothing, you know, you really gotta find an opportunity that's going to strengthen your application. So be that research in PM&R or advocacy or a not-for-profit job, you know, you have to look at your application, and that's when you got to circle back to your student services and your school to see where are the holes, what can you do. I mean, that's it's two very different, or three possibly even different scenarios, so I'm not entirely sure where to go with that one, but keeping it consistent with the U on paper is going to be the best option that you have.
Okay. And it could also be that you had a very good profile, but you always wanted to get that master's in public health. And so it could be part of that. And you can do research in rehab communities, you know, PT with, you know, different associations or groups that can sort of help, you know, buffer that goal while you get your master's in public health. So, or whatever degree, but some people get a master's of business, whatever it is, you know, a lot of people now are looking at that and doing that.
Okay, great. So this concludes our attending portion of our match Q&A. We just want to thank all the attendings that have taken the time to volunteer for our panel tonight. We really appreciate all the insight and tips that you've given us. And I know that a lot of the students appreciate a lot of these insights that we might not get otherwise.